Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Can everyone hear me? Is this live? Yeah, okay, great. All right, I know there'll be some people coming in, but I think we're gonna go ahead and start the event this evening. I'm very grateful to all the co-sponsors for putting on this event, the Office of Religious Life, USC Spectrum, the Annenberg Center for Public Diplomacy, and the Claremont School of Theology. So I'm very, very grateful to everyone for participating in this event, for co-sponsoring this event, and for all of you for braving the cold weather to be with us this evening. Before we begin, I just want to announce two other events that the Office of Religious Life is doing with Spectrum. Tomorrow night, we're hosting Gotham and Deepak Chopra at Bovard Auditorium. They will be talking about their new book, Walking Wisdom. And you can RSVP at Spectrum or even just show up tomorrow at Bovard. I suggest showing up at 7, that's when doors open. And secondly, a week from tomorrow, which is October 13th, in this very room, is that correct, Dave?
Yes.
We're hosting an event called Theater in a Crowded Fire, Ritual and Spirituality at Burning Man. Many of you may know the Burning Man Arts Festival. We have the founder of Burning Man coming to speak with an author who wrote a book about ritual and spirituality at Burning Man. So it'll be a very interesting exploration of spirituality and the arts. And I invite all of you to come to both events. They're free and open to the public. And they'll both be followed by a book signing and a book sale, as will tonight's event. So we have a very special evening for you with Manal Omar and her release of Barefoot in Baghdad. And I'm very grateful to my dear friend and colleague, Najiba Saeed Miller, professor of interreligious education at the Claremont School of Theology. She's also an attorney, a peacemaker, someone who's deeply invested in reconciliation amongst the Abrahamic faiths. And tonight will essentially be a conversation between Najiba and Manal, and then Najiba will open it up for questions and answers. We'll follow that with a book sale and signing in the back and a reception where you can meet Najiba and Manal afterwards. So, without further ado, please join me in welcoming to USC Najiba Saeed Miller and Manal Omar.
Good evening. I'm really pleased to introduce Manal Omar. Manal has quite an illustrious career. In addition to being a best-selling author, which we hope we'll add that to the list tonight, she has been someone that has epitomized the intersection of being an American, being a person of faith, being a peacemaker, and her journey to the work that she did is quite varied. She was in Iraq, actually, quite a while ago, working on issues related to the sanctions at that time, and then proceeded to work with Women for Women, and is now at the United States Institute of Peace, which is a wonderful institution established by the Congress. Is that correct?
That's correct.
The Congress, to focus on thinking, doing, and researching mechanisms for peace and conflict resolution all over the world. And so she's now back in Iraq, and we're really delighted to have her here. Manal and I have known each other since we were quite young, so this is wonderful to be able to meet. This is the kind of conversation we would have at Caribou Coffee down the street from USIP, although you guys have moved your headquarters now to a much more fashionable spot on the mall, though not as good coffee around.
That's true.
So we thank you for joining us tonight, and we really would like to thank Dean Sony. I sent him an email and said, you know, I know this wonderful woman named Manal Omar. I think she'd be a great addition to the USC family of events. I think this week alone there are 5 or 6 events. I can't keep up with Dean Sony, so I'm delighted to be here, and we thank him for his efforts and the Office of Religious Life, all of the staff and volunteers and students. So for those of you that have read the book, you can tell that Manal's spirit is joyful, it's delightful, it's stubborn, it's tenacious, she's ethical in what she does. She holds on dearly to a lot of different principles, and I was struck by the opening of the book, as many of you may have been. You know, she talks about the decision to go to Iraq was a family decision. And so, you know, we hear about your family and their responses to your decision. It took you 3 months to work on both of them. And I wanted to ask you a little bit, you know, what happened before we meet your family in that book? What was your growing up like? What's your story? We kind of have a snapshot of you at that period, but I imagine you didn't just burst from your father's head like Zeus. So tell us a little bit about your story.
I guess my family story is very similar to most immigrant stories in terms of my parents were originally from Palestine, and they settled in a university town first in Lubbock, Texas, and then in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And we were very fortunate because my parents raised us in terms of openness and being open to the different cultures, being thankful for the country that accepted us. So, you know, we were raised very patriotic in terms of being thankful to the U.S. because as Palestinians, we weren't accepted anywhere else. And, you know, that type of, you know, feeling of that now this is our home and that, you know, we are very much American. For example, in South Carolina, my parents very often would send us to Bible school every Sunday because that's who our neighbors were and they wanted us to be open. And it wasn't seen as a contradiction of our Muslim identity. It was just, this is now the community you belong to. You need to be aware of it. And I now, being much older, I appreciate that openness that my family had, kind of exposing us to everything. The other thing that my parents really strongly emphasized was education. You know, that was always considered the second passport, is what your degree is and what your education is. And for a very young age, I remember my father telling me, I don't care what you do as long as you're the best at it. So, you know, whatever you decide to do, go ahead, do it, but, you know, excel. So he didn't know that his own words would haunt him when I decided to do, you know, conflict resolution and development and international development, and realized I couldn't do it from the comforts of DC. You know, I needed to actually be out in the field. I needed to travel overseas and to work with the communities. And I had previously worked with some of the larger agencies. I had worked with the United Nations and worked with the World Bank, but it didn't give me that grassroots, you know, work that I wanted. I wanted to really be able to work with communities. I was very passionate about women's issues. I wanted to work very closely with women directly. And so when I came back and, you know, during the first chapter, I talk about that discussion with my father, that negotiation to be able to travel. You know, keep in mind, I was in my late 20s. So, you know, my boss, all my friends were saying, are you seriously, you know, going through this whole process? Just accept a job and go. It's an opportunity of a lifetime. But for me, you know, my family's blessing was extremely important, and also I knew that it would be tied to my success, that, you know, if my parents were happy with me going, then I would probably, you know, be able to do much more while I was there.
Yeah, I was struck with, you had one of the lines in your book, you were talking about, you know, am I a sellout? Am I going to be a sellout? And what does that mean to be a sellout, while also feeling very strongly, as you mentioned, that you wanted to be actively engaged. So it seemed like those were choices that were presented to you, and maybe if you can talk a little bit more about that, because I think in this day and age, when we utilize the term American, and whether you're a religious person or Muslim, it seems very often that the way that it's talked about is that's an oxymoron, and if you could talk a little bit about that, what was that like emotionally to go through in terms of dealing with your parents' reaction? And I love the email that your father sent you about, if any of you read the book, it's great, it's a great line, but if you'd like to talk a little bit about that struggle, that internal struggle that you were going through.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because, you know, kind of looking at my own personal life and seeing that how much inner struggle represented so much more. There was, you know, obviously the identity issue in terms of who am I representing. You know, one of the things that my mother kept saying was that you're not Iraqi. Why are you going to sacrifice your life for, you know, a country that you don't even belong to? And, you know, for me, it was, you know, obvious. It was the larger social justice issues. It was kind of being a part of the global community, not looking at a specific one country over the other. And I think that a lot of people struggle with that in terms of what's our role in the kind of global international community. You know, the other issue was, you know, looking very much at my stance on war. And, you know, I was always an anti-war activist. And what everyone that I had worked with before was saying, anyone who goes to Iraq is seen as going with the US troops. So there was a direct tie, as if I was, you know, going with the military. And the fact that I was working with the aid community or working in the humanitarian sphere, a lot of people couldn't see that, and it was seen as a contradiction in terms of no. And people literally would say any success is a Bush success. And for me, it wasn't about the politics. And I think that, you know, those who work in the humanitarian and international relations understand that, you know, for the international field, that humanitarian space is sacred and can't be political. So all the political analysts, all the things have to be suspended. And the big question is who's suffering and how do we deliver services? And those questions were so obvious to me that when everyone was bringing in the political side, you know, it left me a little dumbfounded. I didn't know how to respond. And so it made me question, you know, am I selling out? Is this something else that, you know, I'm not thinking of? Is there another angle? Am I being used? That was the big, you know, a lot of people said you're going to be used. And so, you know, how do you make sure that your agenda and the work that you're intending to do stays true once you arrive was a big difficulty, something I really struggled with. And the reason why I started saying it's a larger debate is today one of the biggest debates in the humanitarian sphere is civilian and military relations and how do you work under the code of conduct. And I think I kind of went through a very personal side of that when I first went out to Iraq, trying to understand, you know, there is clearly the counterpart, which is the military there, but there's also this humanitarian space, and where does one end and where does the other begin?
You know, one of the things I was struck when I was reading this book, it's sort of like Eat, Pray, Love boot camp style or extreme style for those of you that have read, for the 20 million people that have read that personal journey. I was struck by, I think you talked about being attracted to places of danger and having a love affair with just the idea of going. And I thought that was fascinating. You know, we were meeting with students earlier today and we were talking about, I've done a lot of conflict resolution in zones here in the U.S. that others might consider difficult or dangerous. And so speak a little bit about that, sort of that love affair and what keeps drawing you to places where, you know, others might, from sort of the context of where your parents were coming from or other friends and family, what is that about?
Well, I mean, two things. One thing was Iraq specifically. I had worked under the UN in Iraq in 1997 and 98, and Iraq was the first Arab Muslim country I'd ever lived in. And that meant a lot to me. You know, I had grown up in the South and, you know, living in the US. I had always heard about the Arab world, heard about the Muslim world, but I never experienced it. So, you know, when I lived in Iraq from 97 to 98, that was kind of the beginning of a love affair with the country. And, you know, you hear about the sanctions, you hear about the war, you hear about the destruction. And what I tried to do in the book was give the personal side, you know, the day-to-day side. You know, who are these people who are living in these areas? Who are these people who survived sanctions? And that's what I saw and that's what I fell in love with, was there was so much art, there was so much culture, there was such a rich tradition in Iraq. And, you know, I felt very much that if these people inside Iraq are willing to fight, then I want to be by their side. So that was kind of the beginning of the love affair. And in 2003, when the war happened, I knew I wanted to go back. The other part was, and this is going to sound, you know, kind of like a oxymoron in terms of conflict can be very exciting. A window of opportunity opens up after conflict.
So are you an adrenaline junkie?
I am not an adrenaline junkie.
You could have just gone, you know, bungee jumping.
No. I think it's the potential. I mean, after conflict, the whole social contract between the government and the people has been dissolved. You know, it's an opportunity to really leap forward when you're talking about human rights, when you're talking about women's rights. You know, everything is being restructured, everything's being renegotiated. The key is making sure that the right people are at the table. And what usually happens is the most vulnerable and the most marginalized aren't at the table. And I saw a role for me there in terms of being inside countries, and you know, Iraq is only one of the countries I've worked on. I've worked on Afghanistan, I've worked in Israel, I've worked in Palestine, I've worked in Lebanon. And you know, those first initial months when the country's rebuilding, it's essential that the voices of the marginalized are heard. And that's generally what the humanitarian community tries, I underline that word, tries to do.
Yeah, I think the idea of the difference between peacemaking, peace building, and peacekeeping has really evolved. It used to be that we would look at a conflict and think about parachuting in, doing aid, and leaving. And I think thinking about the cycle that if peace building isn't happening after conflict, that you have to go back and start all over again. So the recurrence of conflict. So I was kind of fascinated by, in the book, you talk about your initial meetings in Baghdad with other NGOs and just the lack of coordination. And for those of us following the story in Haiti, maybe if you could talk a little bit about that. What is, you know, there's obviously the post-conflict scenario, you have the military presence, but what is it like? One of the stories that really was surprising to me is that very often the NGO leaders had agendas of their own, and there was a difference between the European NGOs and the American NGOs. And so maybe if you could talk a little bit about coordination and what that was like, and sort of whether you felt NGOs were often in step with the population or out of step, and maybe relay some of those experiences.
I think that's one of the big lessons learned that still needs to happen. I can't think of any country where I've worked in where you found good coordination. And sometimes it's not only between the NGOs, just between the different UN agencies alone, there can be an entire thesis written about how to coordinate the UN.
I'm sure there is.
Several and not read. So, you know, what could be done in terms of improving interagency links. And then, you know, also what we saw and we suffered from in Iraq was coordination between the various U.S. actors. So the Pentagon and the State Department, you know, very different agendas, very different discussions. And like you said, it was a little bit disappointing to see that that had also entered into the humanitarian space as well. And so there was a division within even the NGOs. Early on, the obsession was the legality of the war. So, you know, once we entered Iraq, you know, there was just a reality in terms of it happened and Iraqis were suffering. How could we alleviate Iraqi suffering? Instead, a lot of NGOs had positions on the war, and that's what divided their, you know, who they coordinated with, who they worked with. A lot of them wanted to hold the U.S. accountable. And so rather than talking about delivery of services for Iraqis, their concentration was how do we hold the U.S. accountable, which is an important issue in itself. But again, you know, the type of work that I was there to do was to focus on providing services for the Iraqis. And, you know, there also became a lot of identity issues. You know, I remember a lot of people would tease me and say, you know, we can't bear to hear your American accent. You know, and there was automatically an assumption that because I was an American aid worker, then I was feeding all the information to the military. You know, the other thing was, you know, working on women's issues and being covered. A lot of people would say to me, you know, oh, how can you be promoting women's issues, but you're representing patriarchy by being a covered woman? And so, you know, there was all these stereotypes that I had to break down that were existing in the international NGOs who I had initially thought would be my biggest allies.
And what were some of your own stereotypes that you brought to your work? Because I think you see a transformation for those that have read the book. You sort of had a personal journey yourself, whether it was stereotypes about the, you know, individual members of the military, some of them became allies in your work, or stereotypes about Iraqi women. And so I think, you know, that would be interesting if we could hear a little bit about that and any specific stories.
Yeah, a lot. I mean, I think it's probably hard for a lot of you to imagine, but I'm kind of an opinionated person. So when I went into Iraq, I came in with my opinions and thought that I had it all figured out. You know, as an Arab, as a Muslim, I knew what the Iraqis needed. And when I entered, I figured out that I was, you know, very far from the truth. You know, what Iraqis interpreted in terms of the war early on was very different than what I had assumed. And I, you know, imagined, you know, I kind of entered apologetic. I'm so sorry for what the U.S. government has done. And Iraqis were saying, no, we're happy that Saddam is gone. And, you know, we don't want to talk about why we went in. We want to talk about what's going to happen now. There was a lot of, you know, very strong sense in terms of, you know, pointing the finger at other Arab nations. So, you know, I thought that there would be an initial solidarity as an Arab. There was a stronger solidarity to me as a woman. So, you know, different parts of my identity that I thought would be beneficial actually turned to be liability. And, you know, having to work across that and, you know, work with the communities to be accepted was something that, you know, I hadn't initially thought. And as I mentioned, you know, the whole debate on civilian military, under the UN Code of Conduct, most humanitarian agencies will not work with the military. And I came very much from that Code of Conduct background, if a humanitarian was on one side and military was on another. But, you know, that's being redefined, and I think it was probably being redefined from Somalia on. I don't think it's just Iraq. You know, Somalia, Afghanistan, and Iraq have begun to redefine the military and civilian type of work in international development, and particularly in emergency and conflict zones. And so, you know, that, you know, coming in with such a strong black and white, and beginning to realize that there was more negotiations that needed, and that the biggest mandate that I had was to actually listen to the Iraqi people and to hear what they wanted, what they said, and what their priorities were, and suspend my own judgment, my own thoughts, and be true to reporting on what I heard.
I think what was fascinating, one of the lessons that you talk about in the book is that initially the words that you used were that you had a set of people you wanted to work with, a set of people you didn't work with, but what you kind of learned in that process was you had to work with everybody. And so I think it redefines that notion of neutrality. We want to go into a situation and be neutral, but in fact, very often, more and more, when we are redefining the word neutral and saying that we have to be able to be honest brokers. So how did you navigate what was ethical and what wasn't ethical for your existence in that space, especially as you were working with women? Because, you know, as I was reading your relationships with many of the other actors in the book and the characters, it seemed that you certainly wanted to be sensitive, but then you also wanted to push forward on some issues related to gender. So what was that? I mean, how did you navigate that?
I think the field that I come from, which is development, is very different than conflict resolution, and the fact that we don't pretend to be neutral. We're very clear, again, you know, surprise, surprise, on our opinions. So for example, on issues that relate to women, we're very clear in terms of we think this is wrong, which automatically takes us out of the role of being a neutral party. And we really come as advocates to speak on the most marginalized. I think the biggest lesson was making sure that my assumptions weren't being translated to what we thought Iraqis needed. You know, I think it was really a recognition that women all over the world, and you know, Iraq is not an exception, they know what they want, they know what they need, and they know what their priorities are.
Tell my husband that.
Yeah, and agree with you. And it's true, we can prove it over and over. And I think the key for the international community is to listen to that and to hear what, you know, the people on the ground are saying, and then to use our voices as people who are able to speak the language, and I don't mean just English, but the international community lingo, and translate the most marginalized voices as they want to be heard. And it's not an easy thing to do, because you think you know, and you know, I can't tell you how many times I would say to myself, Iraqis have it wrong. You know, this is what they really need. And being able to put myself in check and say, no, they know what they need, and you know, my assumptions need to be suspended, and to really listen to what the Iraqi women want.
So let's talk about some of the characters in the book. And by the way, this was real, right?
Yes.
Oh, okay. It's not inspired by true events.
Yeah.
Yes. No. It had to be true. It was just such an amazing story. So you were living with four men at one point, correct? So Fadi, who was right, Fadi, who was Christian, right? And Mais, yeah, who was a secular Shia, Yusuf, who was a practicing Shia, Salah, who was a Sunni Muslim. So you had kind of a microcosm of the Iraqi reality of the diversity. So maybe first of all, for those that haven't yet read the book, explain to me a little bit about why you were living with four men and how you justify that to your father.
Scandalous.
There's no good book without scandal.
Yeah, definitely not. Well, the way the situation, I mean, this is true. You know, early 2004, I'd been in Iraq for almost a year, and the situation began to deteriorate. Around this time, this is the time, if you guys remember the news, where Fallujah first took place, the first Fallujah battle. And, you know, a part of me, this is where the stubbornness had come in, a part of me, you know, we were just beginning to see our work materialize, and I didn't want to leave. And I, you know, was like, I don't want to leave. Most of the international community had fled to Jordan by this time. I was one of the only aid workers that was still in Iraq. And the other half had moved into the green zone, which is now called the international zone, which is a fortified area, which is covered by the military. And I felt if I moved into the green zone, then I would be cut off from the people that I was working with. And I couldn't justify moving into the green zone. At the same time, I couldn't bear the thought of leaving Iraq when our programs were just taking off. And so I was, you know, in this dilemma, what do I do? And that's when these four Iraqi men who worked with me came and said, the same way that you're taking risks to work for our country, we want to take risks and work for you, and we want to stay with you. You know, we know that you need security, and we know that you need it 24 hours.
So were they putting their lives on the line
to
do that?
They were definitely putting their lives on the line. And what's interesting about the four is you mentioned they represented different parts of the Iraqi community, but they were childhood friends, and they grew up together since, you know, elementary school, and they knew they could trust each other. So if it was, you know, just a random four people coming together, then they wouldn't have been able to provide that protection for me. But because they knew each other, they were stronger than any other, you know, brothers that I'd ever met. I mean, just such a strong love and affection for each other till today. You know, until today, these, you know, through, well, one of them, I won't ruin the story, but anyways, so until today, they're very, you know, very strongly linked, and the families are linked and they care about each other. And when I called my father and explained the whole situation, of course his first reaction was, get out. You know, that was the first thing,
get
leave.
Get out, please.
I love how you describe in the book the butt and the putt being transposed in Iraqi English.
Every immigrant's experience.
Yes.
And so, you know, when he saw that I wasn't going to leave, and of course, again, you know.
Yeah, I was thinking when you describe your father, is that part of the tenacity? It seems that it runs in the family, so maybe that's part of the heritage, even though you have to deal with it. It's also one of the gifts that you have received from your parents, right? So
definitely, yeah. Definitely. And so then he agreed, and that's how I had these four guys in my house.
Okay, wonderful. And you know, I was struck by another the stories. They're the stories of the men that put their lives on the line, and that brotherhood that is such a beautiful story, because I think so much of what we hear about Iraq is the disunity and the reality that people who are from different communities don't get along, and that there's an inevitability of conflict between communities. So I think that story is symbolic. That's why I listed the heritages of all the people. I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the strong women in this story besides yourself. And so talk a little bit about Zainab Salvi from Women for Women, and a little bit about the model of development for Women for Women. If you could just talk about that.
Zainab Salvi is the founder of Women for Women International, and I'll go on just a quick tangent to tell you her personal story, because it's really important. It's one that really resonated with me in terms of one person being able to make a difference. And you know, what's kind of funny about, you know, in America, we've all grown up with the stories of heroes and this idea of one person making a difference, and it speaks to you. And meeting someone who's actually done that was the big kind of push for me to be able to go to Iraq. Zainab Salvi in 1991, you know, was watching the news. Her and her husband, they'd just gotten married, and they had this, you know, elaborate trip, honeymoon trip to Spain planned, and she saw a story about camps in Bosnia, about the rape camps of women, and she said, you know, I can't possibly go on this honeymoon and know that this is out there. So she cashed in her tickets and cashed in, you know, the trip that she had. Her and her husband agreed, and they said, we're going to take this money. It was about $10,000 that they had all together, and we're going to send it to Bosnia. They started doing research and trying to find out an organization that would be able to deliver the money to the women in Bosnia, and couldn't find anyone. And so at that point, they decided, we're going to go out and we're going to deliver the money. A local Methodist church that was nearby heard about her trip and said, you know what, we've been having the same dilemma.
Methodists are awesome. I teach at a Methodist university. So.
Okay.
I mean, interject there, but you know.
But so this awesome Methodist church called Zainab and was like, we're there, we're going to raise money. And, you know, I think, 15 years later, they have 10 country offices all across the globe. They work directly supporting women. It's one of the few sponsorship programs where it's literally a woman to woman. So, you know, a lot of sponsorship programs, you put money and then, you know, it supports several people through different issues, but you're actually a woman paired with a woman overseas. And in addition to funds, you exchange letters and you exchange communication. It's extremely powerful because in conflict, women are cut off. So when they're finally able to get this letter from someone in Europe and Canada and America that's talking about their own personal lives, suddenly these women in war feel connected to the international community again. So that's just kind of Zainab's own story. And the method of development, as I said, is just this one-to-one, and it's also about empowerment, you know, knowing your rights, being able to access your rights, but in a very pragmatic form. I mean, when you go to conflict and you talk to women, they'll tell you, right, it's beautiful, but we want food, we want health care, we want access to clean water. So what Women for Women does is it starts out by providing job skills training so that women can earn an income. Once that program's launched, we go into the program, which is more about rights awareness and discussions about how to protect your rights from a legal perspective.
So you kind of work your way up Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Okay, that's a great model. So, you know, I was struck by one line that Zainab Salvi said about you, which was talking about your American identity and having to listen to Nelly's It's Hot, It's Getting Hot in Here. I forget, that song is old now, you know, so yeah. I don't remember the exact title, but having to listen to it in the radio all the way. So I thought that was a great, and then you list all your favorite groups. Which in fact we have a lot of the same musical taste, which dates both of us.
Yeah,
Nirvana. Yes, certainly it dates us. But I wanted you to talk a little bit about some of the Iraqi women, the stories of those that were working on the ground. Is it Saadia or I'm not sure how she pronounces it. Saadia.
Yeah.
I'm Kashmiri, we say Saadia, but in the Arab world they say it a little different. So talk a little bit about her and Khanum and some of the other women that you met. Who, in fact, it seemed almost once you were able to be open to what they were doing and their spirit and their ability to problem solve, that it kind of gave you permission to be comfortable. Because I was really struck by when you first met Zainab and you said, how could she eat in the middle of a conflict? How could she be so relaxed? What's wrong with her? Isn't she feel as crazy as I do? And I can imagine that, you know, when you first get into that scenario, that one would want to kind of play it out that way, the nervousness and anxiety. So maybe talk to us a little bit about the women that you met on the ground that were doing this type of work already.
Amazing, powerful Iraqi women were on the ground, and there's always been a tradition of very strong women in Iraq. I mean, Iraq, like many other things, in terms of they were the leading in the region on healthcare, they were the leading in the region on education, and they were the leading on women's rights. The Iraqi personal status law, which deals with inheritance and divorce and marriage, was one of the strongest laws since 1958. You know, Iraqi women had the right to vote since 1980. A lot of their neighboring countries still don't have that right. So, you know, when I came in, you find these really strong older women who have been working on Iraq, you know, on rights for a long time. I say older because, you know, one grandmother, an Iraqi grandmother, told me, you know, Iraq is one of those countries where you've actually had to watch generation after generation get worse. And, you know, every grandmother's dream is to see her granddaughter have opportunity to more than she did. Whereas you'll find in Iraq, the grandmothers who've traveled, who, you know, have higher education, you'll find the mother who maybe has a BA, but, you know, has traveled only to neighboring countries, and the granddaughter who's only finished high school, she's lucky and never left her area. And that's because of sanctions and the Iran-Iraq, you know, war, and then the several wars. So by the time you got into Iraq, you saw this huge discrepancy between, you know, the younger generation and the older generation. And the older generation is where I started forging the allies. A lot of these women that I mentioned in the book, you know, as they become exposed, some of them were participants, so people who were part of the program. As they became exposed to the program, the way they just started leaping forward, something that we would plant, they would, you know, could start trailblazing in their own way what was important. And other women like Khanum, who runs a women's shelter in the north of Iraq in the Kurdish area, was really very much taking huge risk in providing shelter and support for Iraqi women all across the country. And she did it in a way that I think is really very unique in the region itself, which was that she didn't just provide protection to women, but she actually would capture all their stories. So for example, you know, women who were, you know, who were violence against women or who were under honor crimes who were killed, she had a deal with the hospital where they would usually call her before they called the police. And she would come to the morgue and she would actually take pictures of the burn victims and all these corpses. And then the next time, which was the third component of her work, so she had this research component, was when she started campaigning and advocating with decision makers about it. Their first response, as we all know, is this never happens, this is exaggeration, this is a Western ploy. She would show them the pictures. And she would always say that would automatically make everyone quiet because she was able to show the proof. And she also worked within the community, and she always emphasized this isn't part of the culture, this isn't part of the religion. She provided them a safe space where people weren't, you know, didn't have to be on the defensive, and was saying this isn't normal in our society. We have to fight it first. And you know, she taught me a lot about the approach of how to work within the community on some of the most controversial topics.
And you talk about another woman, Fern, that really inspired your work, and you talk about, really, if you want to tell her story, it's a very powerful story, and what it's like to work with people who are there one day, and you don't know if they're going to be there the next day. So if you could talk a little bit about what it's like to be in that environment.
The story of Fern is still one that it makes me very emotional because, like many people who worked on Iraq, Fern ended up giving her life for women in Iraq. And she very much was dedicated to women, and she was one of the few people who, you know, refused to live behind fortified, she lived in the southern provinces, but wouldn't live in the buildings, wouldn't live with the military, refused to have armed escort. And she was brutally killed in Iraq in 2004. And it was a very hard thing to come to terms with because I knew Fern was very well loved and accepted in the community. And she had very much the same approach that a lot of us had, which was, you know, we work within the community and we, you know, we don't isolate, we don't hide behind walls, we don't do things. And she was pushing, consistently pushing and advocating for women's issues. And I think that it brought a recognition that the lines were beginning to be blurred in Iraq. You know, before, again, this question that I had earlier in terms of the civilian military, before, you know, you knew that there was the military, and aid workers and civilians were almost always protected. I mean, you see throughout the last three decades, you know, there's international aid workers that live in Palestinian refugee camps that are, you know, throughout the Congo, throughout Sudan. You know, you see these workers who've always been parts of the community. And starting again, I would say probably Somalia, but it really became aware in Iraq and now even Afghanistan, they became targets. And, you know, Fern was one of the first people who kind of highlighted this civilian who, in my opinion, did things the right way, really, really was part of the community, was really dedicated to the community, and yet paid her, you know, the highest price for the work that she did.
So if you could pick one story of the women that you worked with and you tell stories, I mean, what I find, you know, as a professor that teaches conflict resolution, you're in a constant state of negotiation. So you're negotiating with people about just very simple things of where's the symbolism of where a woman spends the night was so profound. You know, we think about kind of here, you know, in Los Angeles, being able to, you know, where you spend the night. It reminded me actually quite a bit of when I was working on issues of gang violence. If you were in the wrong territory, in the wrong space, or the wrong place, or if we look back at the history of the U.S., if you were the wrong color in the wrong place, you know, your life could be at risk. So what was that like to have to even think about where someone spends the night being an issue? And you know, what were some of the stories of the women that you worked with that inspired you to keep going? I know that, you know, there are several people that you just couldn't let go of and you probably had to at some point. So if there are any stories that you wanted to share, I thought that was fascinating. You must be a master negotiator right now. So you know, maybe talk a little bit about that.
I would say maybe a master listener was what I finally learned to do. And, you know, those four guys were among the best advisors in terms of saying, you know, there was one point, and I share this story in more detail in the book, but where, you know, I might have had to spend the night in a police station, which was governed by U.S. soldiers and the U.S. military. And I knew, you know, with the four guys staying in the house, that was a negotiation process. I got my father's blessing. There were rules set. Their families were involved. Their mothers were visiting every morning. Like, you know, there were things that we did to make it as appropriate as possible in a conflict zone. But if I were to spend that one night in the police, then I would have been labeled a collaborator. I would have been labeled a lot of other worse things. And I don't know if I would have instinctively picked up on it because I was so much in the case and I was working with this young woman and that's all I was thinking about. It was very much, you know, in this case, Yusuf, who was saying, that's suicide. The moment you do that, maybe you'll help this girl, but no other Iraqi woman will touch you. You will become an untouchable woman in the community. You have to leave. And that meant taking risks. For example, you know, at the time there was a curfew, so having to break the curfew to try and go home. And there was, you know, there was people who were watching the police station. So, you know, there's all other risks, and you had to balance it out. You know, I'm going to help this one woman, but then I probably would have had to leave Iraq because I wouldn't have been accepted by the community. And I think it wasn't so much negotiations, although that's in the end what I was constantly doing. It was being sure to listen and to know who to trust and not ignore them, because a lot of times, and you know, those who work in international development, your local staff know the context. And I have seen over and over where local staff, international staff will ignore their local staff. And it's, I mean, that is what is, you know, kind of professional suicide in the field.
I was struck by one other thing, that there was a line in the book that you talked about every time before you left your house, you sort of left in what Muslims call a state of purity. You had did all your prayers because you didn't know if you'd be returning, so you wanted to meet your creator in a way that was that was ready for that ultimate end. And so it seems, you know, you're living with the constant reality of death, potentially for yourself and for others. And we're going to go into questions, but I thought if you could talk a little bit about your wedding day, because I remember the way you describe it, most of us, you know, when we're growing up, we think our wedding day, especially if we watch Hollywood stupid chick flicks, you know, our wedding day, that's going to be the most wonderful day. And I was struck by the line in the book that your association on your wedding day was with death again, so even as you had were removed from the situation. So what is that like to constantly be in that state of mind, thinking about